The name Charlemagne, by which the emperor is normally known in English, comes from the French Charles le Magne, meaning Charles the Great. In modern German, Karl der Große has the same meaning. His given name was simply Charles, Latin Carolus, Old High German Carlus, Romance Carlo. He was named after his grandfather, Charles Martel, a choice which intentionally marked him as Martel's true heir. The nickname Magnus Great may have been associated him already in his lifetime, but this is not certain. The contemporary Latin Royal Frankish Annals routinely call him Carolus Magnus Rex, Charles the Great King. As a nickname, it is only certainly attested in the works of the poet Saxo around 900, and it only became standard in all the lands of his former empire around 1000. By the 6th century, the western Germanic tribe of the Franks had been Christianized, due in considerable measure to the Catholic conversion of Clovis I. Francia, ruled by the Merovingians, was the most powerful of the kingdoms that succeeded the Western Roman Empire. Following the Battle of Tertre, the Merovingians declined into powerlessness, for which they have been dubbed the Vafenons, do nothing kings. Almost all government powers were exercised by their chief officer, the mayor of the palace. In 687, Pepin of Herstal, mayor of the Palace of Austrasia, ended the strife between various kings and their mayors with his victory at Tertre. He became the sole governor of the entire Frankish kingdom. Pepin was the grandson of two important figures of the Austrasian kingdom, Saint Arnulf of Metz and Pepin of Landen. Pepin of Herstal was eventually succeeded by his son Charles, later known as Charles Martel, Charles the Hammer. After 737, Charles governed the Franks in lieu of a king and declined to call himself king. Charles was succeeded in 741 by his sons Carloman and Pepin the Short, the father of Charlemagne. In 743, the brothers placed Childeric III on the throne to curb separatism in the periphery. He was the last Merovingian king. Carloman resigned office in 746, preferring to enter the church as a monk. Pepin brought the question of the kingship before Pope Zachary, asking whether it was logical for a king to have no royal power. The Pope handed down his decision in 749, decreeing that it was better for Pepin to be called king, as he had the powers of high office as mayor, so as not to confuse the hierarchy. He, therefore, ordered him to become the true king. In 750, Pepin was elected by an assembly of the Franks, anointed by the archbishop, and then raised to the office of king. The Pope branded Childeric III as the false king, and ordered him into a monastery. The Merovingian dynasty was thereby replaced by the Carolingian dynasty, named after Charles Martel. In 753, Pope Stephen II fled from Italy to Francia, appealing to Pepin for assistance for the rites of Saint Peter. He was supported in this appeal by Carloman, Charles' brother. In return, the Pope could provide only legitimacy. He did this by again anointing and confirming Pepin, this time adding his young sons Carolus, Charlemagne, and Carloman to the royal patrimony. They thereby became heirs to the realm that already covered most of Western Europe. In 754, Pepin accepted the Pope's invitation to visit Italy on behalf of St. Peter's rites, dealing successfully with the Lombards. Under the Carolingians, the Frankish kingdom spread to encompass an area including most of Western Europe. The east-west division of the kingdom formed the basis for modern France and Germany. Ommen portrays the Treaty of Verdun 843 between the warring grandsons of Charlemagne as the foundation event of an independent France under its first king Charles the Bald, an independent Germany under its first king Louis the German, and an independent intermediate state stretching from the Low Countries along the borderlands to south of Rome under Lothair I, who retained the title of emperor and the capitals Aachen and Rome without the jurisdiction. The Middle Kingdom had broken up by 890 and partly absorbed into the Western Kingdom, later France, and the Eastern Kingdom, Germany, and the rest developing into smaller, buffer, nations that exist between France and Germany to this day, namely Benelux and Switzerland. Charlemagne was the eldest son of Pepin the Short and Bertrada of Lohn, born before their canonical marriage. He became king of the Franks in 768 following his father's death, initially as co-ruler with his brother Carloman I, until the latter's death in 771. As sole ruler, he continued his father's policy towards the papacy and became its protector, removing the Lombards from power in northern Italy and leading an incursion into Muslim Spain. He campaigned against the Saxons to his east, Christianizing them upon penalty of death and leading to events such as the massacre of Wadden. He reached the height of his power in 800 when he was crowned Emperor of the Romans by Pope Leo III on Christmas Day at Old St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. Charlemagne has been called the father of Europe, Pater Europi, as he united most of Western Europe for the first time since the classical era of the Roman Empire and united parts of Europe that had never been under Frankish or Roman rule. His rule spurred the Carolingian Renaissance, a period of energetic cultural and intellectual activity within the Western Church. The Eastern Orthodox Church viewed Charlemagne less favorably due to his support of the Filioque and the popes having preferred him as emperor over the Byzantine Empire's first female monarch, Irene of Athens. These and other disputes led to the eventual later split of Rome and Constantinople in the Great Schism of 1054. Charlemagne died in 814. He was laid to rest in the Aachen Cathedral, in his imperial capital city of Aachen. Charlemagne married at least four times, and had three legitimate sons who lived to adulthood. Only the youngest of them, Louis the Pious, survived to succeed him. He also had numerous illegitimate children with his concubines. By the 6th century, the Western Germanic tribe of the Franks had been Christianized, due in considerable measure to the Catholic conversion of Clovis I. Francia, ruled by the Merovingians, was the most powerful of the kingdoms that succeeded the Western Roman Empire. Following the Battle of Tertre, the Merovingians declined into powerlessness, for which they have been dubbed the Vafenons, do-nothing kings. Almost all government powers were exercised by their chief officer, the mayor of the palace. In 687, Pepin of Herstal, mayor of the Palace of Austrasia, ended the strife between various kings and their mayors with his victory at Tertre. He became the sole governor of the entire Frankish kingdom. Pepin was the grandson of two important figures of the Austrasian kingdom, Saint Arnulf of Metz and Pepin of Landen. Pepin of Herstal was eventually succeeded by his son Charles, later known as Charles Martel, Charles the Hammer. After 737, Charles governed the Franks in lieu of a king and declined to call himself king. Charles was succeeded in 741 by his sons Carloman and Pepin the Short, the father of Charlemagne. In 743, the brothers placed Childeric III on the throne to curb separatism in the periphery. He was the last Merovingian king. Carloman resigned office in 746, preferring to enter the church as a monk. Pepin brought the question of the kingship before Pope Zachary, asking whether it was logical for a king to have no royal power. The Pope handed down his decision in 749, decreeing that it was better for Pepin to be called king, as he had the powers of high office as mayor, so as not to confuse the hierarchy. He, therefore, ordered him to become the true king. In 750, Pepin was elected by an assembly of the Franks, anointed by the archbishop, and then raised to the office of king. The Pope branded Childeric III as the false king, and ordered him into a monastery. The Merovingian dynasty was thereby replaced by the Carolingian dynasty, named after Charles Martel. In 753, Pope Stephen II fled from Italy to Francia, appealing to Pepin for assistance for the rights of Saint Peter. He was supported in this appeal by Carloman, Charles' brother. In return, the Pope could provide only legitimacy. He did this by again anointing and confirming Pepin, this time adding his young sons Carolus, Charlemagne, and Carloman to the royal patrimony. They thereby became heirs to the realm that already covered most of Western Europe. In 754, Pepin accepted the Pope's invitation to visit Italy on behalf of St. Peter's rites, dealing successfully with the Lombards. Under the Carolingians, the Frankish kingdom spread to encompass an area including most of Western Europe. The east-west division of the kingdom formed the basis for modern France and Germany. Ommen portrays the Treaty of Verdun 843 between the warring grandsons of Charlemagne as the foundation event of an independent France under its first king Charles the Bald. an independent Germany under its first king Louis the German, and an independent intermediate state stretching from the Low Countries along the borderlands to south of Rome under Lothair I, who retained the title of emperor and the capitals Aachen and Rome without the jurisdiction. The Middle Kingdom had broken up by 890 and partly absorbed into the Western Kingdom, later France, and the Eastern Kingdom, Germany, and the rest developing into smaller, buffer, nations that exist between France and Germany to this day, namely Benelux and Switzerland. The most likely date of Charlemagne's birth is reconstructed from several sources. The date of 742, calculated from Einhard's date of death of January 814 at age 72, predates the marriage of his parents in 744. The year given in the Annales Pétaviennes, 747, would be more likely, except that it contradicts Einhard and a few other sources in making Charlemagne 67 years old at his death. The month and day of the 2nd of April are based on a calendar from Lush Abbey. In 747, Easter fell on the 2nd of April, a coincidence that likely would have been remarked upon by chroniclers but was not. If Easter was being used as the beginning of the calendar year, then the 2nd of April 747 could have been, by modern reckoning, April 748, not on Easter. The date favored by the preponderance of evidence is the 2nd of April 742, based on Charlemagne's age at the time of his death. This date supports the concept that Charlemagne was technically an illegitimate child, although that is not mentioned by Einhard in either, since he was born out of wedlock. Pepin and Bertrada were bound by a private contract of Fredelehe at the time of his birth, but did not marry until 744. Charlemagne's exact birthplace is unknown, although historians have suggested Aachen in modern-day Germany, and Liege-Herstal in present-day Belgium as possible locations. Aachen and Liege are close to the region whence the Merovingian and Carolingian families originated. Other cities have been suggested, including Durren, Gauting, Merlinburch, Quiesy, and Prum. No definitive evidence resolves the question. The Latin chronicles of the end of Visigothic Hispania omit many details, such as identification of characters, filling in the gaps and reconciliation of numerous contradictions. Muslim sources, however, present a more coherent view, such as in the Tariq Iftitar al-Andalus, History of the Conquest of al-Andalus. By Ibn al-Kutiya, the son of the Gothic woman, referring to the granddaughter of Witiza, the last Visigothic king of a united Hispania, who married a Moor. Ibn al-Kutiya, who had another, much longer name, must have been relying to some degree on family oral tradition. According to Ibn al-Kutiya, Witiza, the last Visigothic king of a united Hispania, died before his three sons, Almund, Romulo, and Ardabast, reached maturity. Their mother was queen regent at Toledo, but Roderic, army chief of staff, staged a rebellion, capturing Cordoba. He chose to impose a joint rule over distinct jurisdictions on the true heirs. Evidence of a division of some sort can be found in the distribution of coins imprinted with the name of each king and in the king lists. Witiza was succeeded by Roderic, who reigned for 7.5 years, followed by Achilla Aquila, who reigned 3.5 years. If the reigns of both terminated with the incursion of the Saracens, then Roderic appears to have reigned a few years before the majority of Achilla. The latter's kingdom is securely placed to the northeast, while Roderic seems to have taken the rest, notably modern Portugal. The Saracens crossed the mountains to claim Ardo's Septimania, only to encounter the Basque dynasty of Aquitaine, always the allies of the Goths. Ardo the Great of Aquitaine was at first victorious at the Battle of Toulouse in 721. Saracen troops gradually massed in Septimania, and in 732 an army under Emir Abdul Rahman al-Ghafiqi advance into Vasconia, and Ardo was defeated at the Battle of the River Garonne. They took Bordeaux and were advancing towards Tours when Ardo, powerless to stop them, appealed to his arch-enemy, Charles Martel, mayor of the Franks. In one of the first of the lightning marches for which the Carolingian kings became famous, Charles and his army appeared in the path of the Saracens between Tours and Poitiers, and in the Battle of Tours decisively defeated and killed al-Ghafiqi. The Moors returned twice more, each time suffering defeat at Charles' hands, at the River Bere near Narbonne in 737 and in the Dauphine in 740. Odo's price for salvation from the Saracens was incorporation into the Frankish kingdom, a decision that was repugnant to him and also to his heirs. Loss and recovery of Aquitaine after the death of his father, Hunaldi allied himself with Free Lombardy. However, Odo had ambiguously left the kingdom jointly to his two sons, Hunald and Hatto. The latter, loyal to Francia, now went to war with his brother over full possession. Victorious, Hunald blinded and imprisoned his brother, only to be so stricken by conscience that he resigned and entered the church as a monk to do penance. The story is told in Annales Metensis Priores. His son Waffa took an early inheritance, becoming Duke of Aquitaine and ratified the alliance with Lombardy. Waffa decided to honor it, repeating his father's decision, which he justified by arguing that any agreements with Charles Martel became invalid on Martel's death. Since Aquitaine was now Pepin's inheritance because of the earlier assistance that was given by Charles Martel, according to some the latter and his son, the young Charles, hunted down Waffa, who could only conduct the guerrilla war, and executed him. Among the contingents of the Frankish army were Bavarians under Tassilo III, Duke of Bavaria, and Agilolfing, the hereditary Bavarian ducal family. Grifo had installed himself as Duke of Bavaria, but Pepin replaced him with a member of the ducal family yet a child, Tassilo, whose protector he had become after the death of his father. The loyalty of the Agilolfings was perpetually in question, but Pepin exacted numerous oaths of loyalty from Tassilo. However, the latter had married Liutperga, a daughter of Desiderius, king of Lombardy. At a critical point in the campaign, Tassilo left the field with all his Bavarians. Out of reach of Pepin, he repudiated all loyalty to Francia. Pepin had no chance to respond as he grew ill and died within a few weeks after Waffa's execution. The first event of the brothers' reign was the uprising of the Aquitanians and Gascons, in 769, in that territory split between the two kings. 1 year earlier, Pepin had finally defeated Waffa, Duke of Aquitaine, after waging a destructive, 10-year war against Aquitaine. Now, Hunald too led the Aquitanians as far north as Angoulême. Charles met Carloman, but Carloman refused to participate and returned to Burgundy. Charles went to war, leading an army to Bordeaux, where he set up a fort at Frenzac. Hunald was forced to flee to the court of Duke Lupus II of Gascony. Lupus, fearing Charles, turned Hunald over in exchange for peace, and Hunald was put in a monastery. Gascon lords also surrendered, and Aquitaine and Gascony were finally fully subdued by the Franks. Marriage to Desiderata. The brothers maintained lukewarm relations with the assistance of their mother Bertrada, but in 770 Charles signed a treaty with Duke Tassilo III of Bavaria and married a Lombard princess, commonly known today as Desiderata, the daughter of King Desiderius, to surround Carloman with his own allies. Though Pope Stephen III first opposed the marriage with the Lombard princess, he found little to fear from a Frankish-Lombard alliance. Less than a year after his marriage, Charlemagne repudiated Desiderata and married a 13-year-old Swabian named Hildegard. The repudiated Desiderata returned to her father's court at Pavia. Her father's wrath was now aroused, and he would have gladly allied with Carloman to defeat Charles. Before any open hostilities could be declared, however, Carloman died on 5 December 771, apparently of natural causes. Carloman's widow Gerberga fled to Desiderius' court with her sons for protection. Ambiguous high office. The most powerful officers of the Frankish people, the mayor of the palace Mayor Domus and one or more king's rex, regis, were appointed by the election of the people. Elections were not periodic, but were held as required to elect officers ad quo summa imperii pertinbat, to whom the highest matters of state pertained. Evidently, interim decisions could be made by the Pope, which ultimately needed to be ratified using an assembly of the people that met annually. Before he was elected king in 751, Pepin was initially a mayor, a high office he held, as though hereditary, velut hereditario fingerbeger. Einhard explains that, the honor, was usually, given by the people, to the distinguished, but Pepin the Great and his brother Carloman the Wise received it as though hereditary, as had their father, Charles Martel. There was, however, a certain ambiguity about quasi-inheritance. The office was treated as joint property, one mayorship held by two brothers jointly. Each, however, had his own geographic jurisdiction. When Carloman decided to resign, becoming ultimately a Benedictine at Monte Cassino, the question of the disposition of his quasi-share was settled by the Pope. He converted the mayorship into a kingship and awarded the joint property to Pepin, who gained the right to pass it on by inheritance. This decision was not accepted by all family members. Carloman had consented to the temporary tenancy of his own share, which he intended to pass on to his son, Drogo, when the inheritance should be settled at someone's death. By the Pope's decision, in which Pepin had a hand, Drogo was to be disqualified as an heir in favor of his cousin Charles. He took up arms in opposition to the decision and was joined by Grifo, a half-brother of Pepin and Carloman, who had been given a share by Charles Martel, but was stripped of it and held under loose arrest by his half-brothers after an attempt to seize their shares by military action. Grifo perished in combat in the Battle of Saint-Jean-de-Maurienne while Drogo was hunted down and taken into custody. On the death of Pepin, the 24th of September 768, the kingship passed jointly to his sons, with divine assent, divino nutu. According to the life, Pepin died in Paris. The Franks, in general assembly, generally conventu, gave them both the rank of a king regis, but partitioned the whole body of the kingdom equally, totum regni corpus ex equo parterentia. The annals tell a slightly different version, with the king dying at Saint Denis, near Paris. The two, lords, domini, were elevated to kingship, elevati sunt in regnum Charles on the 9th of October in Noyon, Carloman on an unspecified date in Sussens. If born in 742, Charles was 26 years old, but he had been campaigning at his father's right hand for several years, which may help to account for his military skill. Carloman was 17. The language, in either case, suggests that there were not two inheritances, which would have created distinct kings ruling over distinct kingdoms, but a single joint inheritance and a joint kingship tenanted by two equal kings, Charles and his brother Carloman. As before, distinct jurisdictions were awarded. Charles received Pepin's original share as mayor, the outer parts of the kingdom bordering on the sea, namely Neustria, western Aquitaine, and the northern parts of Austrasia. While Carloman was awarded his uncle's former share, the inner parts, southern Austrasia, Septimania, eastern Aquitaine, Burgundy, Provence, and Swabia, lands bordering Italy. The question of whether these jurisdictions were joint shares reverting to the other brother if one brother died or were inherited property passed on to the descendants of the brother who died was never definitely settled. It came up repeatedly over the succeeding decades until the grandsons of Charlemagne created distinct sovereign kingdoms. Formation of a new Aquitaine in southern Gaul. Aquitaine had been Romanized and people spoke a Romance language. Similarly, Hispania had been populated by peoples who spoke various languages, including Celtic, but these had now been mostly replaced by Romance languages. Between Aquitaine and Hispania were the Euskaldunic, Latinized to Vascons, or Basques, whose country, Vasconia, extended, according to the distributions of place names attributable to the Basques, mainly in the western Pyrenees but also as far south as the upper Ebro River in Spain and as far north as the Garonne River in France. The French name Gascony derives from Vasconia. The Romans were never able to subjugate the whole of Vasconia. The soldiers they recruited for the Roman legions from those parts they did submit and where they founded the region's first cities were valued for their fighting abilities. The border with Aquitaine was at Toulouse. In about 660, the Duchy of Vasconia united with the Duchy of Aquitaine to form a single realm under Felix of Aquitaine, ruling from Toulouse. This was a joint kingship with a Basque duke, Lupus I. Lupus is the Latin translation of Basque Otsoa, wolf. At Felix's death in 670, the joint property of the kingship reverted entirely to Lupus. As the Basques had no law of joint inheritance but relied on primogeniture, Lupus in effect founded a hereditary dynasty of Basque rulers of an expanded Aquitaine. Vasconia and the Pyrenees. The destructive war led by Pepin in Aquitaine, although brought to a satisfactory conclusion for the Franks, proved the Frankish power structure south of the Loire was feeble and unreliable. After the defeat and death of Wiofor in 768, while Aquitaine submitted again to the Carolingian dynasty, a new rebellion broke out in 769 led by Hinault II, a possible son of Wiofor. He took refuge with the allied Duke Lupus II of Gascony, but probably out of fear of Charlemagne's reprisal, Lupus handed him over to the new king of the Franks, to whom he pledged loyalty, which seemed to confirm the peace in the Basque area south of the Garonne. In the campaign of 769, Charlemagne seems to have followed a policy of overwhelming force, and avoided a major pitched battle. Wary of new Basque uprisings, Charlemagne seems to have tried to contain Duke Lupus's power by appointing Seguin as the Count of Bordeaux, 778, and other counts of Frankish background in bordering areas, Toulouse, County of Fezensac. The Basque Duke, in turn, seems to have contributed decisively a scheme, the Battle of Roncevaux Pass, referred to as Basque treachery. The defeat of Charlemagne's army in Roncevaux, 778, confirmed his determination to rule directly by establishing the Kingdom of Aquitaine, ruled by Louis the Pious, based on a power base of Frankish officials, distributing lands among colonizers and allocating lands to the church, which he took as an ally. A Christianization program was put in place across the High Pyrenees, 778. The new political arrangement for Vasconia did not sit well with local lords. As of 788, Adalric was fighting and capturing Chaucon, Carolingian Count of Toulouse. He was eventually released, but Charlemagne, enraged at the compromise, decided to depose him and appointed his trusty William of Gellone. William, in turn, fought the Basques and defeated them after banishing Adalric, 790. From 781, Palace, Ribagorca, to 806, Pamplona, under Frankish influence, taking the County of Toulouse for a power base, Charlemagne asserted Frankish authority over the Pyrenees by subduing the southwestern marches of Toulouse, 790, and establishing vassal counties on the southern Pyrenees that were to make up the Marca Hispanica. As of 794, a Frankish vassal, the Basque Lord Belisco al-Galashki, the Gaul, ruled Alava, but Pamplona remained under Cordovan and local control up to 806. Belisco and the counties in the Marca Hispanica provided the necessary base to attack the Andalusians, an expedition led by William Count of Toulouse and Louis the Pious to capture Barcelona in 801. Events in the Duchy of Vasconia, rebellion in Pamplona, Count overthrown in Aragon, Duke Seguin of Bordeaux deposed, uprising of the Basque lords, etc., were to prove it ephemeral upon Charlemagne's death. Charlemagne had 18 children with 8 of his 10 known wives or concubines. Nonetheless, he had only 4 legitimate grandsons, the 4 sons of his 4th son, Louis. In addition, he had a grandson, Bernard of Italy, the only son of his 3rd son, Pepin of Italy, who was illegitimate but included in the line of inheritance. Among his descendants are several royal dynasties, including the Habsburg and Capetian dynasties. By consequence, most if not all established European noble families ever since can genealogically trace some of their background to Charlemagne. At his succession in 772, Pope Adrian I demanded the return of certain cities in the former Exarchate of Ravenna in accordance with a promise at the succession of Desiderius. Instead, Desiderius took over certain papal cities and invaded the Pentapolis, heading for Rome. Adrian sent ambassadors to Charlemagne in autumn requesting he enforce the policies of his father, Pepin. Desiderius sent his own ambassadors denying the Pope's charges. The ambassadors met at Thionville, and Charlemagne upheld the Pope's side. Charlemagne demanded what the Pope had requested, but Desiderius swore never to comply. Charlemagne and his uncle Bernard crossed the Alps in 773 and chased the Lombards back to Pavia, which they then besieged. Charlemagne temporarily left the siege to deal with Adelchis, son of Desiderius, who was raising an army at Verona. The young prince was chased to the Adriatic littoral and fled to Constantinople to plead for assistance from Constantine V, who was waging war with Bulgaria. The siege lasted until the spring of 774 when Charlemagne visited the Pope in Rome. There he confirmed his father's grants of land, with some later chronicles falsely claiming that he also expanded them, granting Tuscany, Emilia, Venice and Corsica. The Pope granted him the title Patrician. He then returned to Pavia, where the Lombards were on the verge of surrendering. In return for their lives, the Lombards surrendered and opened the gates in early summer. Desiderius was sent to the Abbey of Corbie, and his son Adelchis died in Constantinople, a patrician. Charles, unusually, had himself crowned with the Iron Crown and made the magnates of Lombardy pay homage to him at Pavia. Only Duke Aretas II of Benevento refused to submit and proclaimed independence. Charlemagne was then master of Italy as King of the Lombards. He left Italy with a garrison in Pavia and a few Frankish counts in place the same year. Instability continued in Italy. In 776, Dukes Rodgaud of Friuli and Hildeprand of Spoleto rebelled. Charlemagne rushed back from Saxony and defeated the Duke of Friuli in battle. The Duke was slain. The Duke of Spoleto signed a treaty. Their co-conspirator, Aretas, was not subdued, and Adelchis, their candidate in Byzantium, never left that city. Northern Italy was now faithfully his. Southern Italy in 787, Charlemagne directed his attention towards the Duchy of Benevento, where Aretas II was reigning independently with the self-given title of Princeps. Charlemagne's siege of Salerno forced Aretas into submission. However, after Aretas II's death in 787, his son Grimoald III proclaimed the Duchy of Benevento newly independent. Grimoald was attacked many times by Charles or his son's armies, without achieving a definitive victory. Charlemagne lost interest and never again returned to southern Italy, where Grimoald was able to keep the duchy free from Frankish suzerainty. According to the Muslim historian Ibn al-Athir, the Diet of Paderborn had received the representatives of the Muslim rulers of Zaragoza, Girona, Barcelona and Huesca. Their masters had been cornered in the Iberian Peninsula by Abd al-Rahman I, the Umayyad Emir of Cordova. These Saracen, Moorish and Muwallad rulers offered their homage to the King of the Franks in return for military support. Seeing an opportunity to extend Christendom and his own power and believing the Saxons to be a fully conquered nation, Charlemagne agreed to go to Spain. In 778, he led the Neustrian army across the western Pyrenees, while the Austrasians, Lombards, and Burgundians passed over the eastern Pyrenees. The armies met at Zaragoza and Charlemagne received the homage of the Muslim rulers, Suleiman al-Arabi and Qasman ibn Yusuf, but the city did not fall for him. Indeed, Charlemagne faced the toughest battle of his career. The Muslims forced him to retreat. He decided to go home since he could not trust the Basques, whom he had subdued by conquering Pamplona. He turned to leave Iberia, but as he was passing through the pass of Roncesvalles, one of the most famous events of his reign occurred. The Basques attacked and destroyed his rearguard and baggage train. The Battle of Roncevo Pass, though less a battle than a skirmish, left many famous dead, including the Seneschal Egihad, the Count of the Palace Anselm, and the Warden of the Breton March, Roland, inspiring the subsequent creation of the Song of Roland, Le Chanson de Roland. Coronation. Imperial Coronation of Charlemagne, by Friedrich Kulbach, 1861 and 799, Pope Leo III had been assaulted by some of the Romans, who tried to put out his eyes and tear out his tongue. Leo escaped and fled to Charlemagne at Paderborn. Charlemagne, advised by scholar Alcuin, traveled to Rome, in November 800 and held a synod. On the 23rd of December, Leo swore an oath of innocence to Charlemagne. His position having thereby been weakened, the Pope sought to restore his status. 2 days later, at Mass, on Christmas Day, the 25th of December, when Charlemagne knelt at the altar to pray, the Pope crowned him Imperator Romanorum, Emperor of the Romans, in St. Peter's Basilica. In so doing, the Pope rejected the legitimacy of Empress Irene of Constantinople. Pope Leo III, crowning Charlemagne from Chroniques de France au de Saint Denis, Volume 1, France, second quarter of 14th century. When Odoacer compelled the abdication of Romulus Augustulus, he did not abolish the Western Empire as a separate power, but caused it to be reunited with or sink into the eastern, so that from that time there was a single undivided Roman Empire. Pope Leo III and Charlemagne, like their predecessors, held the Roman Empire to be one and indivisible, and proposed by the coronation of Charlemagne not to proclaim a severance of the East and West. They were not revolting against a reigning sovereign, but legitimately filling up the place of the deposed Constantine VI. Charlemagne was held to be the legitimate successor, not of Romulus Augustulus, but of Constantine VI. Charlemagne's coronation as emperor, though intended to represent the continuation of the unbroken line of emperors from Augustus to Constantine VI, had the effect of setting up two separate and often opposing empire and two separate claims to imperial authority. It led to war in 802, and for centuries to come, the emperors of both West and East would make competing claims of sovereignty over the whole. Einhard says that Charlemagne was ignorant of the Pope's intent and did not want any such coronation. H.A. at first had such an aversion that he declared that he would not have set foot in the church the day that the imperial titles were conferred, although it was a great feast day, if he could have foreseen the design of the Pope. A number of modern scholars, however, suggest that Charlemagne was indeed aware of the coronation. Certainly, he cannot have missed the bejeweled crown waiting on the altar when he came to pray, something even contemporary sources support. Debate the throne of Charlemagne and the subsequent German kings in Aachen Cathedral. Historians have debated for centuries whether Charlemagne was aware before the coronation of the Pope's intention to crown him emperor. Charlemagne declared that he would not have entered St. Peter's had he known, according to chapter 28 of Einhard's Vita Caroli Magni, but that debate obscured the more significant question of why the Pope granted the title and why Charlemagne accepted it. Collins points out, had the motivation behind the acceptance of the imperial title was a romantic and antiquarian interest in reviving the Roman Empire is highly unlikely. For one thing, such romance would not have appealed either to Franks or Roman Catholics at the turn of the 9th century, both of whom viewed the classical heritage of the Roman Empire with distrust. The Franks took pride in having fought against and thrown from their shoulders the heavy yoke of the Romans, and, from the knowledge gained in baptism, clothed in gold and precious stones the bodies of the holy martyrs whom the Romans had killed by fire, by the sword and by wild animals, as Pepin III described it in a law of 763 or 764. Furthermore, the new title carrying with it the risk that the new emperor would make drastic changes to the traditional styles and procedures of government, or concentrate his attentions on Italy or on Mediterranean concerns more generally, risked alienating the Frankish leadership. For both the Pope and Charlemagne, the Roman Empire remained a significant power in European politics at this time. The Byzantine Empire, based in Constantinople, continued to hold a substantial portion of Italy, with borders not far south of Rome. Charles sitting in judgment of the Pope could be seen as usurping the prerogatives of the emperor in Constantinople. By whom, however, could he, the Pope, be tried? Who, in other words, was qualified to pass judgment on the vicar of Christ? In normal circumstances, the only conceivable answer to that question would have been the emperor at Constantinople. But the imperial throne was at this moment occupied by Irene. That the Empress was notorious for having blinded and murdered her own son was, in the minds of both Leo and Charles, almost immaterial. It was enough that she was a woman. The female sex was known to be incapable of governing, and by the old Salic tradition was debarred from doing so. As far as Western Europe was concerned, the throne of the emperors was vacant. Irene's claim to it was merely an additional proof, if any were needed, of the degradation into which the so-called Roman Empire had fallen. For the Pope, then, there was no living emperor at that time, though Henry Pyon disputes this, saying that the coronation was not in any sense explained by the fact that at this moment a woman was reigning in Constantinople. Nonetheless, the Pope took the extraordinary step of creating one. The papacy had since 727 been in conflict with Irene's predecessors in Constantinople over a number of issues, chiefly the continued Byzantine adherence to the doctrine of iconoclasm, the destruction of Christian images, while from 750, the secular power of the Byzantine Empire in central Italy had been nullified. By bestowing the imperial crown upon Charlemagne, the Pope arrogated to himself the right to appoint the Emperor of the Romans, establishing the imperial crown as his own personal gift but simultaneously granting himself implicit superiority over the emperor whom he had created. And, because the Byzantines had proved so unsatisfactory from every point of view, political, military and doctrinal, he would select a Westerner, the one man who by his wisdom and statesmanship and the vastness of his dominions, stood out head and shoulders above his contemporaries. With Charlemagne's coronation, therefore, the Roman Empire remained, so far as either of them, Charlemagne and Leo, were concerned, one and indivisible, with Charles as its emperor, though there can have been little doubt that the coronation, with all that it implied, would be furiously contested in Constantinople. Alcuin writes hopefully in his Letters of an Imperium Christianum Christian Empire, wherein, just as the inhabitants of the Roman Empire had been united by a common Roman citizenship, presumably this new empire would be united by a common Christian faith. This is the view of Pyne when he says, Charles was the emperor of the Ecclesia as the Pope conceived it, of the Roman Church, regarded as the universal Church. The Imperium Christianum was further supported at a number of synods all across Europe by Paulinus of Aquileia. What is known, from the Byzantine chronicler Theophanes, is that Charlemagne's reaction to his coronation was to take the initial steps towards securing the Constantinopolitan throne by sending envoys of marriage to Irene, and that Irene reacted somewhat favorably to them. It is important to distinguish between the universalist and localist conceptions of the empire, which remain controversial among historians. According to the former, the empire was a universal monarchy, a commonwealth of the whole world, whose sublime unity transcended every minor distinction. And the emperor was entitled to the obedience of Christendom. According to the latter, the emperor had no ambition for universal dominion, his realm was limited in the same way as that of every other ruler, and when he made more far-reaching claims, his object was normally to ward off the attacks either of the Pope or of the Byzantine emperor. According to this view, also, the origin of the empire is to be explained by specific local circumstances rather than by overarching theories. According to Onsorge, for a long time, it had been the custom of Byzantium to designate the German princes as spiritual sons of the Romans. What might have been acceptable in the 5th century had become provoking and insulting to the Franks in the 8th century. Charles came to believe that the Roman emperor, who claimed to head the world hierarchy of states, was, in reality, no greater than Charles himself, a king as other kings, since beginning in 629 he had entitled himself, Basileus, translated literally as, king. Onsorge finds it significant that the chief wax seal of Charles, which bore only the inscription, Christ, protege Carolum regem Francorum Christ, protect Charles, King of the Franks, was used from 772 to 813, even during the imperial period, and was not replaced by a special imperial seal, indicating that Charles felt himself to be just the King of the Franks. Finally, Onsorge points out that in the spring of 813 at Aachen, Charles crowned his only surviving son, Louis, as the emperor without recourse to Rome with only the acclamation of his Franks. The form in which this acclamation was offered was Frankish Christian rather than Roman. This implies both independence from Rome and a Frankish non-Roman understanding of empire. Imperial title. Charlemagne used these circumstances to claim that he was the renewer of the Roman Empire, which had declined under the Byzantines. In his official charters, Charles preferred the style Carolus Serenissimus Augustus Adio Coronatus Magnus Pacificus Imperator Romanum Gubernans Imperium, Charles, Most Serene Augustus crowned by God, the great, peaceful emperor ruling the Roman Empire, to the more direct Imperator Romanorum, Emperor of the Romans. The title of emperor remained in the Carolingian family for years to come, but divisions of territory and infighting over supremacy of the Frankish state weakened its significance. The papacy itself never forgot the title nor abandoned the right to bestow it. When the family of Charles ceased to produce worthy heirs, the Pope gladly crowned whichever Italian magnate could best protect him from his local enemies. The empire would remain in continuous existence for over a millennium, as the Holy Roman Empire, a true imperial successor to Charles. Imperial diplomacy. Europe. Around 814, the iconoclasm of the Byzantine Isaurian dynasty was endorsed by the Franks. The Second Council of Nicaea reintroduced the veneration of icons under Empress Irene. The council was not recognized by Charlemagne since no Frankish emissaries had been invited, even though Charlemagne ruled more than three provinces of the classical Roman Empire and was considered equal in rank to the Byzantine Emperor. And while the Pope supported the reintroduction of the iconic veneration, he politically digressed from Byzantium. He certainly desired to increase the influence of the papacy, to honor his savior Charlemagne, and to solve the constitutional issues then most troubling to European jurists in an era when Rome was not in the hands of an emperor. Thus, Charlemagne's assumption of the imperial title was not a usurpation in the eyes of the Franks or Italians. It was, however, seen as such in Byzantium, where it was protested by Irene and her successor Nikephoros I, neither of whom had any great effect in enforcing their protests. The East Romans, however, still held several territories in Italy, Venice, what was left of the Exarchate of Ravenna, Reggio in Calabria, Otranto in Apulia, and Naples the Ducatus Nepalitanus. These regions remained outside of Frankish hands until 804, when the Venetians, torn by infighting, transferred their allegiance to the Iron Crown of Pippin, Charles' son. The Pax Nicephori ended. Nicephorus ravaged the coasts with a fleet, initiating the only instance of war between the Byzantines and the Franks. The conflict lasted until 810 when the pro-Byzantine party in Venice gave their city back to the Byzantine emperor, and the two emperors of Europe made peace. Charlemagne received the Istrian peninsula, and in 812 the Emperor Michael I Rangabe recognized his status as emperor, although not necessarily as emperor of the Romans. In 813, Charlemagne called Louis the Pious, king of Aquitaine, his only surviving legitimate son, to his court. There Charlemagne crowned his son as co-emperor and sent him back to Aquitaine. He then spent the autumn hunting before returning to Aachen on the 1st of November. In January, he fell ill with pleurisy. In deep depression, mostly because many of his plans were not yet realized, he took to his bed on the 21st of January, and as Einhard tells it, he died January 28th, the seventh day from the time that he took to his bed, at 9 o'clock in the morning, after partaking of the Holy Communion, in the 72nd year of his age and the 47th of his reign. He was buried that same day, in Aachen Cathedral, although the cold weather and the nature of his illness made such a hurried burial unnecessary. The earliest surviving Planctus, the Planctus de Obitu Caroli, was composed by a monk of Bobbio, which he had patronized. A later story, told by Otho of Lomelo, count of the palace at Aachen in the time of Emperor Otto III, would claim that he and Otto had discovered Charlemagne's tomb. Charlemagne, they claimed, was seated upon a throne, wearing a crown and holding a scepter, his flesh almost entirely incorrupt. In 1165, Emperor Frederick I reopened the tomb again and placed the emperor in a sarcophagus beneath the floor of the cathedral. In 1215, Emperor Frederick II reinterred him in a casket made of gold and silver known as the Karlskrian. Charlemagne's death emotionally affected many of his subjects, particularly those of the literary clique who had surrounded him at Aachen. An anonymous monk of Bobbio lamented, "From the lands where the sun rises to western shores, people are crying and wailing, the Franks, the Romans, all Christians, are stung with mourning and great worry, the young and old, glorious nobles, all lament the loss of their Caesar. The world laments the death of Charles. O Christ, you who govern the heavenly host, grant a peaceful place to Charles in your kingdom. Alas for miserable me." Louis succeeded him as Charles had intended. He left a testament allocating his assets in 811 that was not updated prior to his death. He left most of his wealth to the church, to be used for charity. His empire lasted only another generation in its entirety. Its division, according to custom, between Louis's own sons after their father's death laid the foundation for the modern states of Germany and France. Einhard tells in his 24th chapter, Charles was temperate in eating, and particularly so in drinking, for he abominated drunkenness in anybody, much more in himself and those of his household. But he could not easily abstain from food, and often complained that fasts injured his health. He very rarely gave entertainments, only on great feast days, and then to large numbers of people. His meals ordinarily consisted of four courses, not counting the roast, which his huntsmen used to bring in on the spit. He was more fond of this than of any other dish. While at table, he listened to reading or music. The subjects of the readings were the stories and deeds of olden time. He was fond, too, of St. Augustine's books, and especially of the one titled, The City of God. Charlemagne threw grand banquets and feasts for special occasions such as religious holidays and four of his weddings. When he was not working, he loved Christian books, horseback riding, swimming, bathing in natural hot springs with his friends and family, and hunting. Franks were well known for horsemanship and hunting skills. Charles was a light sleeper and would stay in his bedchambers for entire days at a time due to restless nights. During these days, he would not get out of bed when a quarrel occurred in his kingdom, instead summoning all members of the situation into his bedroom to be given orders. Einhard tells again in the 24th chapter, in summer after the midday meal, he would eat some fruit, drain a single cup, put off his clothes and shoes, just as he did for the night, and rest for 2 or 3 hours. He was in the habit of awaking and rising from bed 4 or 5 times during the night. Charlemagne as emperor in his role as a zealous defender of Christianity, Charlemagne gave money and land to the Christian church and protected the popes. As a way to acknowledge Charlemagne's power and reinforce his relationship with the church, Pope Leo III crowned Charlemagne Emperor of the Romans on December 25, 800, at St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. As emperor, Charlemagne proved to be a talented diplomat and able administrator of the vast area he controlled. He promoted education and encouraged the Carolingian Renaissance, a period of renewed emphasis on scholarship and culture. He instituted economic and religious reforms, and was a driving force behind the Carolingian minuscule, a standardized form of writing that later became a basis for modern European printed alphabets. Charlemagne ruled from a number of cities and palaces, but spent significant time in Aachen. His palace there included a school, for which he recruited the best teachers in the land. In addition to learning, Charlemagne was interested in athletic pursuits. Known to be highly energetic, he enjoyed hunting, horseback riding and swimming. Aachen held particular appeal for him due to its therapeutic warm springs. According to Einhard, Charlemagne was in good health until the final 4 years of his life, when he often suffered from fevers and acquired a limp. However, as the biographer notes, even at this time, he followed his own counsel rather than the advice of the doctors, whom he very nearly hated, because they advised him to give up roasted meat, which he loved, and to restrict himself to boiled meat instead. In 813, Charlemagne crowned his son Louis the Pious 778-840 King of Aquitaine, as co-emperor. Louis became sole emperor when Charlemagne died in January 814, ending his reign of more than 4 decades. At the time of his death, his empire encompassed much of Western Europe. Charlemagne was buried at the cathedral in Aachen. In the ensuing decades, his empire was divided up among his heirs, and by the late 800s, it had dissolved. Nevertheless, Charlemagne became a legendary figure endowed with mythical qualities. In 1165, under Emperor Frederick Barbarossa 1122-1190, Charlemagne was canonized for political reasons. However, the church today does not recognize his sainthood. Thank you, hope you'd find the content informative. Kindly share the video and subscribe to the channel. Do comment to let us know what are the other subjects you'd like us to cover.